And I steady my heart on the ground of your goodness. When I'm bowed down with sorrow, I will lift up your name. And the foxes in the field will not steal my joy, because you are good to me, God to me. You are good to me, God to me. You are good to me.
You're here, and we're glad to have you. As usual, as you hop on, go ahead and let us know where you're watching from. I am back in Jersey now, so it's good to be back. It was good to be in Texas for several weeks in the summer and to see family and just to be back and miss everything that was going on. But it's good to be back here in Jersey too. And it's good. It's good to know that wherever God has us land, He gives us all the tools to make that home, right? So let us know where you're watching from. We love to see that. And it's always fun to see the different spots and maybe the new spots that pop up that people are watching from. If you are just joining Chosen for the first time, this is a safe space where we as women gather together to encourage each other in the Lord, and to encourage each other to remind each other week after week that our identity should be focused solely on Jesus Christ. And when it is, that is not only the one thing that grounds us in life, but it also is the one thing that as women unites all of us together. We all come from different walks and different backgrounds, but when we have the assurance of salvation through our Savior, that and we can allow our identity to be centered on and founded in our Savior and in Jesus Christ, that is something that unites us forever. And for that, I am so, so thankful. So we're glad that you're here. I have my sister on tonight, and she's going to bring our devotional in just a bit. But before she does, I'm going to have her come on and go ahead and pray for us. I wish that she was in Jersey, but she's not. She's in Texas. And before she comes really quickly, thank you for all of you who have reached out and who have prayed for faithfully for the Peterson and the Gamlin families that lost precious loved ones in the past couple of weeks. And I know that those families appreciate your prayers. I appreciate you praying, and we were watching last night. We had a family and friends movie night at church here in Jersey, and we watched Overcomer. And in that, there was a challenge of a man that was a believer had told somebody he would pray for them. And he was asked later on by the person he told he would pray for, did you pray for me? And he had to answer honestly that he didn't. And, I was convicted to that, because how many times do we flippantly, even though we don't mean it to be flippantly, we say, I'll pray for you, or I'm going to pray for you, or I will. And then we don't follow through and we don't do that. And it convicted me because, one thing that I so admire about my husband is when he says he's going to pray for you, you can rest assured you are going to be prayed for, and then it's going to be followed up on, and then he's going to mark it down. He has a whole system going that when that prayer is answered, he gives thanks to God for answering that prayer. And so, as we think about these families that are going through the unimaginable right now that we have chosen to pray for, I want us to be women that not only say we're going to pray for somebody, but we do it. And then when we see God work in great and mighty ways and bring about things in lives that are going through the unimaginable, it seems impossible to come back from something. God does, and he will do that supernatural work that only he can do to bring peace and to truly draw us closer to him. And so let's be faithful to not only pray, but to praise God when we see things come from hard, heartbreaking things that we say only God could do that. So I just want to challenge us this week, and I'm challenging my own self to be a woman that not only says I'm praying for you, but that goes, that prays, and that commits to follow through on that, and to see it through to the praise, because it will get to that praise. So Holly, if you will go ahead and come on, and also right quick before she comes on, I want us to remember this week, dear friend of ours in Texas that's a part of my dad's church, Annie Cochran, her dad is in ICU and just needs some prayers for some miraculous physical healing. And it's been amazing to see as Annie has asked for prayer, and her sisters and her family have continued to ask for prayer. They're not able because of COVID to go see their dad right now, but God provided a nurse in his hospital room that has been praying over him. And it's just been incredible to see through something really hard that they're going through right now. They're crying out and asking for prayer, and to see God answers in ways we didn't even know. And they're giving God the glory through it all. So it's just, I'm thankful for Annie, and I hope that sometime we can have her on Chosen. I think we can make that happen. Y'all would love her. But anyway, please pray for her, for Annie's dad, if you can remember to pray for Annie's dad. And as Holly comes on, go ahead. If you already are, go ahead and start putting your prayer requests in the comments. Be faithful to grab somebody's, and let's be a group of prayer warriors this week. So Holly, if you will, come on ahead and open us in prayer.
Hi, I'm so excited to be here, albeit virtually. I have to say, we're also having what we in Texas call a cold snap at a cool 60 degrees. So I feel a little closer to Jersey today. I mean, not really, but we're all bundled up. So let's go ahead and pray. God, I just thank you for the time that we have together tonight. And I just pray that you would touch lives, heal hearts, and just help us to soften our hearts to hear the words that we're supposed to hear, and to not just hear them, but to act on them. And God, I just pray that you would be near to us, that you would be with us. And we thank you that you are for us and that you are never far from us. And God, we just pray a special prayer tonight for Annie's sweet dad and her family, that you would just be near to them, that you would comfort them. We pray for your healing power. We pray that you would just touch her dad. And I just pray that you would make what even seems impossible possible, that you would be near to Annie and her entire family, that you would hear the cries of our hearts. And God, we cry out to you for her dad, and we just pray that you would heal him and that you would restore him. And God, I just thank you for the life that you've given all of us, and for the blessings that we all do have in these crazy times. I thank you that we have blessings and we have things to be thankful for. I pray pray that we would have grateful hearts and that we would choose to focus on the things that we can be thankful for, because there's so many, just that we have breath in our lungs and that we have life in you. We have so many things to be grateful for. So God, I just pray that you would help us to focus on those things. And when we don't, I pray that you would continually pull our focus back to you and back to a heavenly perspective. I thank you, God, for all of the people joining tonight, everyone jumping on from near and far, and I just thank you. I thank you for the lives that are being touched. I thank you for the word that's going to be spoken. And God, I just pray that you would soften our hearts to hear the message and not just be hearers of the word, but doers as well. And so I thank you, God, for all that you've given us, blessed us with. I pray that each one of us would have an amazing finish out to the week and on into the weekend, and that we would consider it all joy. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Holly. I don't know about y'all, and I know everything's different across the country, but here in Jersey, my kids are back in school, and I consider that all joy that they are back in school. And I'm going to tell you what, I'm more thankful than ever for their teachers this year and for all that that they do. So teachers, if you are a teacher, thank you for all that you're doing in a normal world and all that you're doing time and a half and times a million right now with all the online learning and the hybrid and everything that's just so different. We love you, we are praying for you, and we are thankful for our teachers, our administrators, our educators, and the staff here at Champion Baptist Academy and across the globe, everyone that is represented as a teacher or an educator. We are thankful for you and we love you. If you are just joining us, this is week 24 of Chosen. I can't believe we're on week 24, but we are. Our theme tonight is forgiveness, and our theme verse for Chosen for every single week of Chosen is Jeremiah 1:5. I always encourage you to circle it, to write it, to write your name in there, and to remind yourself that you are known, that you are loved, that you are called by name by the creator of the universe who knew you before you were even born. The beginning part of that scripture, It reminds us that before we were even born, God knew us and he called us by name. It says, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. And that is always an encouraging scripture to me. And like I always say, I have my name written in that verse. I have it circled. I have it highlighted and underlined. And I love to remind myself that I am a daughter of the King, because listen, I need to be reminded daily that I am. Last week we challenged you to think on who you are rather than what you are not. And it's so easy to fall into that hole of reminding yourself of all the things you are not, instead of remembering and claiming and standing in and living on in that definition of whose you are, and who you are. We took a tiny glimpse into the life of Queen Esther, and we looked at her life and how she never forgot, through everything that she faced, through being orphaned, through being raised by her uncle, through all the trials that life brought her, and then being taken from her home and being taken to the palace to be go there and be one of the maidens that was going to be picked by the king, and life just didn't turn out how she wanted. That is not the life that she saw for herself or that she wanted from the beginning as a young child to her adulthood, but yet she never ever forgot whose she was. And because of that, she recognized and she didn't miss that she was created for exactly how the life that God intended for, even though it wasn't what she saw. And so we saw that as she remembered who she was, she had a laser focus on God, what we called last week a God focus. And we saw last week that there were three things that produced, and that it was blessings that only God through his power can bring out of your trials was the first thing. The second thing was courage that can only be given by God. It's not man-made. You can't get it from anything on this earth, and it's not circumstantial. That's courage that can only come from the Holy Spirit and from the power that God gives. And the third and final thing was favor, that a God focus brings you favor in the eyes of the King. And that favor comes from an inner strength that can only come from the working power that the Holy Spirit can give to us and help. So, you know, as God loves on you and draws you closer to him day after day. He wants you to grow spiritually, and he wants to bring about a healing process in your life that really gives freedom in the areas that you were previously enslaved to. And we're going to look at some of those, and we're going to look at some of the ways that we stay stuck instead of moving forward how God has us. And a huge piece of that is forgiveness. And that's really where we're going to part tonight. And so as we move into our devotional that my sister's going to bring, and then our study on forgiveness tonight, I want you to think about this question. How do you respond when you are hurt? How do you respond when you're hurt? And go ahead and put it in the comments and be honest and raw and real. How is it that you respond when you're hurt? What's your go-to response mechanism when you're hurt? And you know, for me, when I answer that question, and I'm going to ask Holly maybe I'm going to pull her on. She didn't know she was going to do this, but I'm going to pull her on in just a second and get her response to that. How do you respond when you're hurt? But for me, here's how I have to think about that question for myself. It's less of how I respond, and it's more of how I react. And here's what I mean by this. When I respond, I've generally drawn back and I've thought about it, or I've prayed about it, or I've a simple Jesus help, like my little nephew says. You know, I've asked God, I've taken a second, and then I respond. If I'm reacting, it's out of control. And it's, you know, it's really something that comes from a place that isn't where I want to be, and it's not where God wants to have me, right? And so, you know, when I answer that question, I pose it with another one. Am I responding or am I reacting? Holly, when you are hurt, what is the go-to, you know, response mechanism? What is it? How do you respond when you're hurt?
Yeah. So unfortunately, I think my go-to in the flesh mechanism is I get defensive, and oftentimes I'm kind of put this wall up while I'll be nice on the outside, but on the inside, I will never put you in that position again. And I'll just kind of put myself on mute and I won't open myself up to you. And so I think that's tends to be my like visceral reaction. But something that has helped me, that I've been working on, and I'm not perfect at it, but I've been working on, is that when I get hurt, and it seems so silly, but to actually stop and count in my head and start to think, okay, how can I put myself in that person's shoes? Or what is like three things that I can be thankful for, either about that person or about my life? And a lot of times I find that it changes my perspective and it makes me more understanding if I'm willing to do that little exercise, but I'm working on it.
I love that. You know, she takes that, her first thing that she said was her first initial reaction was to wall up. And, you know, I think that's what many of us do. And when that wall goes up, so does usually the grudge that we hold, or the judgment that we place, or the bitterness that gives seed to unforgiveness, right? That works its way. And I love those coping mechanisms that she used. Count to 10. That's simple. We teach our kids that. But that's what I was saying. My response versus my react. I got to take it back. I got to ask for help. I got to ask for help where I know my sin nature is going to come out over what I want that response to be and form a reaction, you know? And so I love that. And I think that that's a great tool to use. And so, you know, real quick, and then she's going to bring the devotional. Let's just talk about forgiveness for a second. If you have your Bibles, I want you to quickly turn to Colossians 3, chapter 3, verse 13. And we're going to look at that scripture. And there's no better example to look at when we talk about forgiveness than the example of our Savior. His entire life is an incredible example of forgiveness, but certainly when we think of his death on the cross and all that he did for us there, the blood shed as he poured himself out for us is the greatest example of forgiveness that we will ever see. Colossians 3:13, if you have it, says, "Forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye." In other words, be merciful, right? In other words, make allowances for each other to be human. We all have an old sin nature. We are all human. Allow space for people to have fault and forgive. And then forgive. Ask God to help you to forgive. You know, knowing that we should forgive somebody doesn't necessarily make it any easier to forgive somebody. And I, more than anyone, realize that. You know, my usual response is, I can forgive a lot of things, but I can't forgive that. Or I'm going to forgive, but I'm not going to forget it. You know, and that usually means I haven't really released to let God do that work in my life that opens the door to tear that wall down and to truly forgive. In the second half of that Colossians 3:13, we see the perfect answer that really wraps up forgiveness. We could stop right here and be done, but we're not gonna. but it says, even as Christ forgave you. You know, there's that example. He forgave us. He's forgiven us not just for the small, insignificant things that seem like they don't matter, but he forgave us for everything, for every thought, for every action, for every sin. He forgave us, you know, and my husband says this all the time. If it's good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for me. If it was good enough for Jesus to forgive as he hung upon the cross and all the wrong and unfair that was done to him, it's good enough for you. It's good enough for me. So I just want us to think about that as Holly goes into our devotional, and then we're going to have three quick points on forgiveness tonight. Holly?
Yeah, I love that, just even thinking, you know, thank goodness God doesn't hold it all against us. Man, the grace he extends. So this devotional is The Healing Power of Forgiveness. All of us have experienced trial and pain. All of us are living life wounded and scarred. We learn to deal with our wounds and press forward. But whether we acknowledge it or not, wounds and scars do change us. There are no perfect parents. There are no perfect friends. There are no perfect siblings or spouses. We live in an imperfect world with imperfect humans. We lash out and hurt others because we are broken and in need of healing. One of the most critical spiritual exercises we can undergo is allowing God to heal our past wounds and guide us to a lifestyle of forgiving present scars. Without healing and forgiveness, other people's mistakes and our own mistakes will affect our future. Without the inner working of the Holy Spirit, we will live in continual suffering from the sins of ourselves and others. Our God is a God of healing. In Psalms 147:3, he says, he healeth the broken in heart and bindeth up their wounds. Psalm 103:2 and 4 says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies. 1 Peter 2:24 says, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sins should live unto righteousness. By those stripes ye were healed. Your heavenly Father longs to speak to the wounded places in your life and heal them with his love. What past experience, trial, hurtful word, or person is still harmfully affecting your life today? Where do you need the Holy Spirit to come and speak healing over you through the power of forgiveness? Where do you need to cry out to God in anger or frustration over a wound? Opening the wounded places of our hearts is an emotional and difficult process. But until we allow God into the harmful events of our past and present to unfold humanly before him, we will never experience true freedom and restoration from them. Until we allow ourselves space to deal with what for some have been painful and defining moments and forgive as he has forgiven us, we will never experience the entirety of the abundant life available to us. And as the Lord begins to heal our wounds, we must allow him to guide us to a lifestyle of forgiveness for our present scars. We must forgive those people who hurt us so the scars in our lives become symbols of God's redeeming love, rather than reminders of those painful events. In James 2:13, it says, for he shall have judgment without mercy that hath showeth no mercy, and mercy rejoiceth against judgment. Show mercy to those who are undeserving of it, just as your heavenly Father has shown you mercy. Love your enemies as Jesus did, so that you can experience rejoicing and triumph instead of pain. Freedom instead of enslavement to negativity, and joy instead of anger. Let your heavenly Father love you, hold you, and care for the places in your heart that need his healing touch the most.
Wow. Thank you, Holly. I love that devotional, and I love the title of it, the healing power of forgiveness, you know, and I think there's so many good takeaways. Go ahead and post in the comment what it was that touched you the most about that devotional. I know when I read it, and when I was listening to Holly give us the devotional, it really stuck out to me, the sentence that says, we must forgive those people who hurt us so the scars in our lives become symbols of God's redeeming love rather than reminders of painful events or a painful past. You know, who has past wounds or scars that are affecting your present circumstances, that are affecting your current state of mind, that are affecting the way that you think, that are affecting the way that you view life today? Maybe it's affecting relationships that have nothing to do with that past wound or scar, but there's been a wall there where you haven't been able to release it and you haven't been able to forgive. And because of that, let me tell you, if you don't forgive, if those past wounds and scars, if those past circumstances and hurts and heartbreaks and gut-wrenching things that happen to us in life, if those things, if you don't forgive and allow God to do a work there, if they're not already affecting your present, they will affect your future. And so that's what we're going to look at tonight. You know, I love, you know, when we forgive, we let the loving kindness of our Creator, of our Savior, do the rest. When we make the choice to forgive, the loving kindness of God and His grace and mercy, He does the work for us. He does the rest. We just have to forgive. You know, I love the definition when you think of loving kindness. What is the loving kindness of God? The word loving kindness means a tender consideration for what others are going through. Now think about that as God looking at you, His daughter. You know, He has a tender consideration for what you're going through. He knows and He cares. And, you know, Psalm 63:3 says, because thy loving kindness is better than life, my lips will praise thee. And I just love that thought that we have something in this, in all of the struggle and the trial, and all of the places where we're not able to forgive, where we're not able to release, where we're holding on to a grudge, where we're holding on to a judgment, where we are enslaved or held captive to our own error in thinking, or maybe it's someone else's, but we just can't let go. We truly are missing out on something that's better than life. And that's experiencing God's love and kindness as we forgive and He does the work for us. You know, what better reason to rejoice despite our present circumstances when we have and can hold on to something and truly grasp and understand the meaning of what it means to hold something that's better than life. And that's resting in the loving kindness of our Creator. So forgiveness tonight, we're just going to have three quick points on forgiveness. And we're going to move right through that. But there have been some things in my life that I don't know that I would say off the bat that it was hard to forgive, but when I looked back on it, it's kind of like that devotional was talking. There were scars that had formed and there were wounds that had formed. And even though I thought that I had forgiven, I hadn't fully released it. And so I think there's a powerful thing that comes with, we can forgive and we can choose to forgive, but it takes the work of the Holy Spirit. It takes the power of Almighty God to bring that release. And that's where we're going to focus on tonight. So the first thing that you will see that forgiveness does and it brings about, forgiveness heals. And what I mean by that is that just exactly what I was talking about before. You can forgive and you can grit your way through that forgiveness, but for that scar and that wound to be something that doesn't affect your present and most certainly doesn't affect the future that God has for you, we have to have the true healing work of Jesus Christ in our life. James 5:16, if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to it. It says, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And Luke 23:34, says, then Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. We go back to that statement we said right before the Devo. If it was good enough for Jesus, it should be good enough for me. If it was good enough for Jesus, it should be good enough for you. He went to the cross. It's good enough. It's good enough for him. It ought to be good enough for us. You know, the will, plan, and purpose that God has for your life is going to unfold. And we pray that it unfolds wrapped up, you know, in his very best for you, and that we have the release that the power of forgiveness brings in our life. But, you know, as we meditate on God's word, as we claim his promises, it softens our heart and it brings us to a place where we can not only give mercy, but we can receive mercy. Because sometimes the hardest thing is to forgive ourselves. The hardest in my life, the things that are hardest for me to give are the things that I held myself to a different standard and I didn't live up to it. It's for me, it's harder to forgive myself than it is others, but we have to. We have to forgive ourselves. We have to have mercy on others and we have to have mercy on ourselves. Jesus has mercy on us. Why can't we do that for ourselves? You know, and that's a real thing. That's a hard thing that I think many of us, if we're being honest, probably struggle with. But as we fill ourselves with the promises of God, he will bring about that healing power to our hearts and our souls to transform and to truly bring that healing. Isaiah 53:5, and I love this scripture. It says, "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed." You know, it kind of repeats what it was saying in James 5:16. But I love that. You know, what an example. What an example of pure forgiveness without any motive, without any motives. You know, when we think about, there are things at work that are bigger than ourselves, right? And I think there's different ways that we can be held captive in life. And I'm going to give you just a few if you want to write them down. And the first one destroys us, and it comes from the enemy. The second one says, good enough. Good enough. I forgave enough. I forgave. I'm moving on. But I'm not going to forget. And then the third one produces God's best in our life. The first one is that there's a force and there is an enemy that seeks to destroy us, that seeks to tell us, you don't need to forgive, hold on to that, they were wrong, you're right, don't back down, hold your ground. And there's times to hold your ground, for sure. But there also are times to recognize that we had a need for a savior to be rescued, and we need to be able to give that same mercy and grace in return. Because if you let the enemy, he will hold you captive in your unforgiveness towards others, towards yourself, toward God, fill in the blank, whatever it is that you're holding, that grudge or that judgment or that bitterness or the unforgiveness in your life. And if you let him, it will destroy you. It will destroy you from the inside out, both physically, mentally, and emotionally. It will completely tear you down and tear you apart to where you no longer have any vision to see what God's will, plan, and purpose, and his ultimately his best is for your life. The second thing is that good enough mentality. You know, there's that pull from your own old sin nature that says, entices you to believe that your own way is good enough, that the way that you forgave was good enough. You addressed it, you moved on, right? But did we really, if it's still there, if there's still the hurt, if there's still a lack of healing, right, from our Savior? We are in that good enough mentality and way will leave you broken. It will leave you hurting. It will leave you not only scarred, but you'll build scarred tissue back up on top of that scar or that wound, so that it's harder and harder to dig out and to get to the root of what God truly wants to heal. So I encourage you to recognize myself, we have to recognize the need that we have for a Savior to fully redeem and restore and heal those hurts, and to bring forgiveness where it just seems that there's not a way. And then that third way is God's way. And that's the best way. He has a very best, as I like to call it, for your life. Why do we settle for destruction, the destruction of the enemy, or the good enough of our own old sin nature mentality, instead of God's best that is right in front of us? Let's forgive. Let's be women that forgive. Let's be women that truly don't hold on to those things, but we release it. And we say, God, I don't want the scar. I don't want the wound, and I don't want the scar tissue. I want to learn what it is you have that you're teaching me in this circumstance. I want to be able to show mercy and compassion and forgive just as you did on the cross. And in that, God will do the healing work in your life. Don't let unforgiveness steal God's best for your life. Let forgiveness heal and bring about God's best for your life. The second thing that forgiveness does is that it reveals. Forgiveness will reveal areas that you need God to speak truth and love into your life, that maybe when forgiveness was there, the bitterness or just the all-consuming thoughts that come when you aren't walking in forgiveness and God's grace and mercy have block and allow make us not be able to see areas that we really need God's revelation in our life. So when you forgive and healing comes and God brings about that healing work that only he can do, a weight is completely lifted off of our shoulders, and you'll see things through a different light. And you know, when God gives you those revelations that comes through the release of forgiveness, it will push you towards spiritual maturity. And that push towards spiritual maturity will be one of the greatest blessings you'll ever experience, both here on this earth and on into eternity. And you know, I don't know about you, but there's nothing that gives my heart greater joy than knowing that there's something that is allowing me to grow spiritually, that I get this revelation and I go, oh God, that's what you were telling me. That's what you were meaning. This is the circumstance you were talking about, and this is how you want me to handle it. And in that comes release and comes healing, but also comes a revelation that allows me to grow spiritually, maybe gives me empathy for somebody down the road, allows you to help somebody else, or allows you to help yourself, right? Forgive. And so what a blessing and an incredible joy that comes from knowing that God uses the hard things in our life to grow us spirit, to grow us closer to spiritual maturity as we push on towards home. Psalms 103 verses 2-4. If you have your Bible, turn to the middle of the Bible, Psalm, and chapter 103, let's start in verse 2. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, and who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies. There's that word forgive. Forgive. He forgives our iniquities. He forgives all our sins. And then I love that last part of verse 4, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies. That is what happens when we forgive. We get to experience something that's better than life, God's loving kindness, that he understands and sees us right where we are, understands what we're going through, and has that compassion for us and his tender mercies. As we're merciful to others, we can sit back and recognize that incredible revelation of how merciful our Savior is to us. So thankful for his mercy. Zephaniah 3:17 says, the Lord thy God in the midst of thee is mighty. He will save, he will rejoice over thee, he will rest in his love, he will joy there with singing. And I just love that. As we forgive and we allow that mighty power of God to go to work in our life, he reveals promises to us that we may have missed before. And that's why I love that scripture in Zephaniah, because to me, it is packed full with promises from our Savior. He's with you. He's mighty. He saves. He loves you. He rejoices over you. He brings rest. He rests in joy over you, and he brings about song, and he sings over you. And I love that. When we forgive, can you imagine how heaven sings? Can you imagine the just rush of angel wings that goes out when we forgive and we release that mercy onto somebody else? What a powerful tool that we have that God gives us, that not only releases somebody else, that releases where we were enslaved and held captive, and then it allows us to have this incredible revelation that reveals God's power and mercy and grace in our life that pushes us to grow spiritually, something that we get to carry with us home into eternity. The third thing that forgiveness does is that it frees. Who wants to be free? You know, there's been this tiny glimpse for my life, you know, as I've gone through, and my late husband served in the military and fighter pilot, and I've always been just very, very aware of the freedom and the cost of freedom. And as we lost my husband, and I've watched for the past 4 years my kids grieve the loss of that, I've never forgotten ever how much freedom costs and that it's not free. And you know, as we've gone through this 2020 and we've seen some of the freedoms that we enjoy, and the ability to gather and to go to church, and some of those things, due to how everything's panned out, we haven't been able to do those things as that we normally do. And you know, freedom is important and it's necessary to survive. And the same is true in our spiritual life. We need to be free. We cannot live a captive life. Not and grow to spiritual growth, have the spiritual growth that God truly intends and for us to have. So forgiveness frees. It frees us from our places of where we're held captive by anger, by bitterness, by resentment, by unforgiveness, where those things have held us captive. When we forgive, we release the power of freedom in each of those places of our life. Forgiveness frees us to have a restored mental attitude that has a right thinking towards God, towards his word, towards how he thinks. It clears our emotions, right? We're emotional beings. I don't know about y'all, but I go through phases where I, oh man, I can feel my emotions taking over and I have to keep them in check. And I fail a lot of times, but you got to forgive yourself. You got to forgive others. You got to move on. You got to allow the freedom that that forgiveness brings. You know, we were talking about last week, that God focus and what that God focus does for us when we're focused on God and not on self and others. And the same thing is true here with forgiveness. When we forgive, we're really not focused on what the other person did to us. We're really not focused on how we were wrong. We're focused on Christ and the example that he gave in forgiving so freely and the mercy that he showed, even though he didn't deserve what was going on. And what happened, he forgave. You know, forgiveness frees us to trust God more. And when we trust God more, that forgiveness brings about an affirmation that really affirms all that is true, that is honest, that is good, that is pure, lovely, and of good rapport and virtuous in life. And if you have your Bible, go ahead and turn to Philippians chapter 4. And we're going to read verse 8. I love the scripture. We've used it before on Chosen. But I just love when we look at this scripture and as we read it, when you are focused and thinking and your thoughts are on these things that we're going to read about in this scripture, in that place is freedom. And without forgiveness, you don't get there. Whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good rapport, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. And jump to verse 9, if you will. And the end of verse 9 says, do these things and the God of peace shall be with you. Who wants the God of peace to be with them? Because I do. Focus on those things. Forgive and God will bring about a freedom in your life you never knew existed before. Forgiveness frees us to draw closer to God. And with that draw, with that willingness to take that first step, towards our Father comes perfect peace that is in him. I want that perfect peace. As we just move to a close here, you know, we have a choice. We can look back at the past. We can point the finger 6 or 7 weeks ago. We touched on this when we were talking about a divine vision. And I think the final roadblock that we had to a divine vision was forgiveness, unforgiveness. And what a huge one that is. And, you know, if they hadn't done me wrong, If I had done this, if they hadn't done that, if God hadn't allowed X, Y, or Z, don't expect God's best to be laid out in front of you if you're constantly pointing the finger back at what was done, what wasn't done, how you were treated, how you were mistreated, how a certain thing should have gone a certain way or a certain circumstance isn't what you thought it would be. Expect that foggy veil of confusion, of pain, of unrest, of bitterness to overtake the spot that God has reserved in your life for his perfect will and plan and purpose to be enacted in your life, for his best to come to pass in your life. You've got to lift that veil. You've got to forgive and allow that freedom that comes. Allow the healing to come. Allow God's revelation power to come into your life and allow the freedom that comes from forgiveness. You know, if you want to see your life through the eyes of God's very best for your life, you have to forgive just as he forgives. We have to show mercy just as he shows mercy. Aren't you thankful for grace? I'm so thankful for grace. You know, we have to choose to believe, just like that devotional that my sister read was saying, that no matter how deep the wound, God can heal it. No matter how hard the trial you're going through, God will see you through it. When you forgive, he'll not only unleash the future of his best specific to your own life, but you'll experience blessings you couldn't even imagine poured out from heaven. They will be poured out endlessly on your life and your relationships that are God-focused. And in that, you will line up specifically with the will and the plan and the purpose and the very best that God has for your life. I'd like to read you a quote here that says, unforgiveness is the enemy's scheme to keep our focus on ourselves, therefore missing the personal sense of destiny that God has for each one of us as chosen daughters of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I'm going to read it again. Unforgiveness is the enemy's scheme to get us to keep our focus on ourselves and therefore missing the personal sense of destiny that God has for each of us as chosen daughters of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It's back to those things. It's the enemy seeks to get us to focus on and to unforgive and to stay enslaved so that he destroys. Or our sin natures tells us good enough. You forgave good enough, and it leaves us held captive. It leaves that, it starts that scar tissue to form. But if we can recognize that God has a personal sense of destiny for each one of us as a daughter of the King, that you are chosen and you are called by name. He loves you. He calls us to forgive just as he did. And in that you will find the most incredible release and peace, than more than you could ever imagine. Release unforgiveness so that you can unleash the blessings through God's best for your life. It will take off. His best for your life, you'll see it unfold, and you're not alone. He takes your hand and he walks with you hand in hand. Forgiveness brings about the healing that we long for in our life. It reveals our need for a greater need for him to be drawn closer to him. It frees us to think like he thinks, and it ultimately leads to rejoicing and praising our King. All of these things are prerequisites for breakthrough. Who doesn't want a breakthrough, right? Who wants to be held captive in unforgiveness? I don't. Who wants to be held captive in the things that have wounded and scarred and hurt us from the past? I don't, because there's a lot of those in my life and I don't want them. I don't want those things to define me. I want those things to make me better. I want those things to allow me to grow spiritually. I want those things to develop the tools that God has given me so that I can use them and carry them onto eternity, and I can carry them with me there, not just things that we lose here on this earth. We need to have forgiveness. We need to allow forgiveness in our life so that we can have that breakthrough that we are so desperately longing for. Forgiveness heals, it reveals, and it frees. As we close in prayer and move to a close tonight, I'm going to share a song, and I want you to listen to the lyrics of this song. It talks about breakthrough, and it talks about how we know the tension and the turmoil and the just sometimes just the hard that is life right now, and we don't always understand. We don't always get to see, but the lyrics say, when I'm counting every breath, Lord, all I need to know is that you choose me. You choose me. And the next line of that song says, I'll praise before my breakthrough till my song becomes my triumph. I will sing because I trust you. I will bring my heart. I will bring my heart. I will lift my song. And I just love the lyrics to that song, and I'm going to put it up so that we can play it here. And you know, I just want us to go into this week and remember that we have to be women that truly forgive, not just the good enough kind of forgiving, but the forgiveness that brings true healing and true restoration and true redemption, and ultimately that triumph and that rejoicing over judgment, right? That rejoicing that God brings, rather than the judgment that can hold us captive when it's God's to do and God's to give. So let's go ahead and close in prayer, and then I'll play the song and share the takeaways. God, I just come to you and I thank you, God, for your son. I thank you for the sacrifice of your son on the cross. I thank you, God, that it affords us healing, that it affords us supernatural spiritual revelation in you, and God, that it affords us freedom. Most of all, God, that sacrifice, it gives us eternal life. And that if there's anyone watching tonight that says, I'm not sure that I'm going to heaven, God, that isn't sure if they quite understand what it means to spend eternity in heaven, God, we want to take this time right now to say, if you don't know for sure that you're going to spend eternity in heaven, we ask, God, right now that you touch each one of those hearts, that you remind each one of those souls that they only need to call on you, your son, as their Savior. To say they believe in Jesus Christ and that he died on the cross for their sins, and that in doing so, they will have eternal life. And God, we just thank you for the sacrifice that the cross represents. We thank you for all the lessons that we learn from the cross and from the sacrifice made there. And we thank you, God, for the power of forgiveness. We thank you for the example that Christ was through his bloodshed, and that through him, we have the greatest example that ever was of forgiveness and how to forgive even when it just seems impossible to and unfair to do, and the release that forgiveness brings. We just thank you for that. I thank you for each one of the women watching tonight. I thank you for each life represented, God. We just pray that you bless each one of these as they go out on their Thursday night and go into their weekend. And we just thank you, God, for the time and the opportunity and the freedom, God, to come together to study your word and to encourage each other in you and in our identity that is centered on you. We just ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As always, if share this live. If tonight blessed you, go ahead and share. We want to be a blessing to others and to share outside of our group. I also want to mention before I play the takeaways that we have a new Chosen page that we will be going live on. We'll still share the live into this group, but if you haven't already, go over to our Chosen page. There's a link on it right below this post that gives you all those details. You can click over to the Chosen page. We're in the Chosen group right now, but you can click over to the Chosen page and you can like it. We'll be posting takeaways there, replays there. When we go live, we'll go live there. We'll still share it in the Chosen group too, but eventually everything will move to that page. And upcoming events in the future, great fun things that we have planned for Chosen as a whole, all of that will be posted there. So make sure you go like and follow that page and share that page with others. We love you all. I am going to do my best here to share these takeaways and this song right now. And I know this song, go ahead and listen to the words of this song. It was a blessing to me every time that I hear it. I love you all. And I will see you next week on Chosen at 8:25 live Eastern time. I hope you'll have a great week.
I know the tension of the night. I don't always understand. I don't always get to see everything. When I'm holding up my head, when I'm counting every breath, Lord, all I need to know is you choose me. You choose me. I'll pray before my breakthrough, till my song becomes my trail. I will sing because I trust you. I will bring my heart, I will lift my soul. When I'm listening for your voice and I'm shutting out the noise, I know that you will speak clearly. When I'm living out my faith, when I'm stepping on the sea, I know you take my hand and walk with me. Walk with me. I'll praise before my breakthrough, till my song becomes my treasure. I will sing because I trust you. I will bring my